and Bill Trampe, lifelong Gunnison County rancher and member of the Gunnison Basin Roundtable. Okay, at this time I'd like to introduce our first speaker. Kevin Rein is the new state engineer and director of the Colorado Division of Water Resources, also known as the State Engineer's Office. Kevin directs the performance of division's responsibilities, including administration of water rights in Colorado, issuing water well permits, performing administrative approvals for water use, administering programs that ensure the safety of dams and the safe construction of water wells, as well as providing information and education resources to the public. He has worked at the Division of Water Resources for 19 years. Kevin is going to explain to us how diversions, return flows, and consumptive use are all related and how consumptive use of a water right is influenced by irrigation efficiency.
Thank you very much, Phil. And so again, Kevin Rein, recently appointed state engineer, and let me just say this is a privilege for me. Before I was a state engineer in my position, I did a lot of work in this area, working through issues like questions on beneficial use, efficiency, conservation, consumptive use. It really lends itself to the conversation that happens at the state capitol when they're considering the issues before them. We've had a very public statewide discussion on use it or lose it in the recent months and years, and these all seem to come together in the same type of discussion. So again, it's a privilege for me to talk about it. I'm going to address some of these points and try to bring them together into one example, one simplified example of an actual field use of water. And so I'll appreciate it if you bear with me as we go through some definitions and some common understanding and build up to that. Today, and there we go. Today, what I'd like to discuss is a few main topics: efficiency and conservation, and just understanding those concepts and terms. What that really means is efficiency and conservation, we need to distinguish those a little bit. But also, that leads into a discussion of diversion of water, beneficial use of water, consumptive use of water, and ultimately how changing that efficiency or altering efficiency has an effect on consumptive use and return flows. We'll step in a little bit to the talk about diversion and consumptive use and the effect on the value of a water right. And again, that's where I'll get into my example that I think will be really helpful for us to illustrate a lot of these points, and maybe say a couple words at the end about how augmentation fits into that whole discussion. As a backdrop to a lot of this discussion, we have to consider there's some fundamental principles, and one of them is prior appropriation, and that is obviously so fundamental to the use of water and the administration of water in Colorado. It is the basis for our statutory law, and we have a large body of statutory law that's written around the prior appropriation concept that really gives us the detail, the ability to apply prior appropriation to all the numerous situations we have. The concept of beneficial use is so important because it can almost sound like a generic term, but it's got a very specific meaning in Colorado water law. So we want to touch on that. And we also want to give some attention to the fact that these diversions of water that we talk about and the way the water is used from that diversion, that's going to be according to an actual water right, something decreed by the court, something that memorializes that beneficial use and the prior appropriation right for the user of the water right. So that's a good backdrop to what we're going to talk about. Now, I said I wanted to distinguish efficiency from conservation. And that might sound like a difficult task with some ambiguous terms, but it's good to think about in Colorado Water Administration that we can distinguish the two terms. And first of all, especially in agriculture, but other water users, efficiency has a very specific meaning. And we can almost boil it down to a mathematical meaning, and that is that efficiency is the ratio of the amount of water that's consumed by a specific beneficial use to the amount of water that is diverted to achieve that beneficial use. That will go a lot better if we look at an example. So I'm going to start, and you'll see this cartoon a couple times as we go through our talk today. But we can start with just a depiction of the river. We'll run a lined canal, to keep it simple, a lined canal off the river to irrigate some of our land. 160 cubic feet per second is going to be diverted from the river for crop irrigation down that lined canal. And we're just saying lined so we can imagine that there are no losses in that lined canal for now. Off that lined canal into a farm lateral, 110 cubic feet per second, or CFS, is diverted from the canal to irrigate field A. In so doing, we're leaving 50 CFS in the canal. Of course, that math works out. But we also need to realize that our farm lateral is a little longer. It's not lined. We're losing about 10% or about 10 CFS to the river through that farm lateral seepage. So that leaves us 100 CFS to apply to the field. And obviously, these are large numbers. It would be hard to imagine diverting 100 CFS onto just one field. But for today's example, it gives us some nice round numbers. So we don't stop there. We've diverted 100 cubic feet per second to the field. And out of that 100 cubic feet per second, in our example, 60 CFS is going to be consumed by the crop through flood irrigation. And by consumed, I mean evapotranspiration. It's taken out of the system, goes away from the hydrologic cycle as far as we can tell. The balance of that 40 CFS, is going to return to the river by the surface or through deep percolation into the groundwater and migrating back to the water, migrating back to the river. So that portion that's not consumed eventually makes its way back to the river. What is our efficiency then? Because that's what we set out to do in this example, is explain efficiency. And our on-farm efficiency is that 60% number. Out of 100 CFS diverted to the field, 60% got consumed. To go a little further on efficiency and to explain it, some examples of improving efficiency in agricultural irrigation would be to modify the method of diversion or application. For example, lining the ditch. If we lined that farm lateral or had our other ditch not been lined and we were losing water from the diversion, we could line that ditch and lose less water. But from a field application, we can do things like switching from flood to sprinkler irrigation and become more efficient. At another level, there are things we can do like our ability to pay to give extra attention to changing our sets or the things that we would do to go even further to become more efficient. Now, an important point about efficiency is that an efficiency change does affect the return flows. We saw how that would work in my last example. And that's going to influence water available upstream or downstream just because of the changes to the timing and location and the amount of that return flow pattern. This is really important. Water not diverted due to efficiency improvements becomes available to the water users of the state to continue to be beneficially used in accordance with the priority system. And I'm going to dive a little bit deeper than I at first thought I would on that point. And I want to say that when a water user becomes more efficient, takes these steps, that may result in the need to divert less water to cover the field, to accomplish that beneficial use. If that irrigator has other land that water right allows irrigation of, they may choose to divert to that land, but the water right, if it does not allow another type of use, for example, leasing it to a neighbor downstream, then that water cannot be protected, that efficiency savings cannot be protected. And again, I went a little bit deeper there, but I wanted to just put that out there, and I understand there may be more questions on that later. Let's continue on at the higher level for now. We're going to distinguish the two terms, efficiency and conservation, and so I do want to point out conservation is a little different. That's modifying the use of the water where the objective is to reduce the amount of water consumed or taken out of the hydrologic cycle. You saw in our efficiency example, we consumed the same amount. We just created a situation where we could divert less water potentially. Conservation, our intent is to consume less water. So conservation might take place by removing the end guns from a center pivot or fallowing a field or maybe irrigating a less consumptive crop. We have to understand that irrigating that less consumptive crop may result in the reduction of water being consumed and may or may not be administratively regarded as a full exercise of the water right. So again, that gets into a nuance that we may have questions on later. Water saved through conservation, again, will likely be consumed by another water user in an over-appropriated system where the stream generally does not have enough water to satisfy all the water rights. A great way to illustrate a lot of these principles is through a change of water right example. That helps us understand so much, and so I'm going to spend a fair amount of time on this, and it's going to go through a commonly done practice, a commonly exercised practice on the rivers in Colorado called a change of water right. What's important about a change of water right is that a senior water right can be transferred to another use. That's the change. For example, from irrigation to commercial, industrial, or municipal uses. What's so nice about that is that the water right retains its senior priority, which is so valuable when you have that senior water right. Good example, like I said, irrigation water transferred to municipal uses. But there's a big caveat there. The process needs to ensure that the water is not used to a greater extent under the new use than it was under the old use. That's to ensure that other water users on the river don't get impacted by that change, which would be material injury. So again, it requires that we look at how the water was used and consumed and the effect it had on the river under its historical beneficial use as decreed. We have to look at that and ensure that the new use does not expand on that. That's what this is all about, quite frankly. So we'll go into our example of a change of water right, and we're going to consider our water right. It's a decreed right for an agricultural ditch for irrigation. And our decree allows us a diversion of 15 cubic feet per second for a defined parcel of land. Here again is that similar drawing, and in our drawing we have a river flowing with 20 CFS, 20 cubic feet per second, and an irrigation canal coming off of it to irrigate land along the way. A little smaller scale than we talked about before, but to illustrate the same principles, in our example we'll divert 10 CFS from the river down the canal and apply it to the field. For our example, I'm going to neglect ditch losses along the way. We diverted 10 CFS, we apply that to the field. That leaves 10 CFS in the river. So this is a pretty simple histogram of what's happening here. I just want to introduce it because we'll be going into more detail on it later. But we had 20 CFS in the river. We divert 10 CFS and that leaves 10 CFS in the river. Fairly straightforward. So here are the questions. We diverted 10 CFS from the river. What is our diversion? Well, that one was pretty simple. Of course, we know that it's 10 CFS. We just diverted it. What is our beneficial use? We don't quite know the answer to that yet. We haven't gotten into enough detail. What about our consumptive use? Don't quite know that yet either. Nor do we know what our return flows are. We have to dig into this analysis a little deeper. So to dig into that analysis, we really want to answer the question, what is the measure of our water right? What are we allowed to transfer? Remember, I said we can only transfer that amount that was historically impacting the river before. That is our limit. How are we going to look at that? Well, first of all, recall we had a 15 CFS water right decreed. So is that anything meaningful as far as our right to change the use? Not really, because we never did divert 15 CFS in our example. Never in the history of the water right did we, in our example, divert 15 CFS. So no, that is not a consideration. We can again look at our 10 CFS diversion, and let's put that into volumetric numbers and say a 10 CFS diversion for a field that's likely going to mean about 1,000 acre feet over the irrigation season. Plus or minus, that's a good number for us to use today. Out of that 1,000 acre feet, 10 CFS, let's say 6 CFS, or what amounts to about 600 acre feet, is consumed by the crop. That's what the crop needed for that acreage, for that crop. That's about all it can really consume. So again, we get back to our return flow amount, deep percolation, flowing off the field and over the ground back to the river. That's going to be about 400 acre feet over this season. That gets back to the river. And you can see down below, remember we started with 20 CFS, we diverted 10 and left 10. With these return flows, average over the season, we're getting about 14 CFS. Now, there are also timing difficulties there, but for the sake of argument, we've got 14 CFS downstream, very important. Breaking our histogram down a little more, we can go into more detail on that diversion block and split it into the 600 acre feet of consumptive use and 400 acre feet of return flows. Important components, as we'll see. Asking our questions again, of course, we know what we diverted. Our beneficial use, we still don't quite know yet, but our consumptive use, we know we consumed about 600 acre feet, and our return flow amount is about 400 acre feet. So we answered a couple questions here. We looked at our performance of our water right, the way it worked on that field, and we know what we consumed, and we know what our return flow was. We left that beneficial use question unanswered, and that's because it's a difficult one. Beneficial use is defined by Colorado statute as the use of that amount of water that is reasonable and appropriate under reasonably efficient practices to accomplish without waste the purpose for which the appropriation is lawfully made. That's quite a sentence, but I think we can make sense out of it fairly quickly. The way we do that is first consider how efficient was our practice. Remember, our efficiency was just that mathematical number. It's 600 acre feet out of the 1,000 acre feet that we applied. We were 60% efficient. And again, that's an objective value. It's not a value judgment. It's not saying we were really good or really bad. It's just a mathematical calculation. Then let's talk about waste. Let's throw that term in. Waste is explained as diverting and or applying more water than is reasonably needed. Here we see that term reasonably again, needed to meet the consumptive use of the crop. This is not necessarily so clear in our case because there are many components. But if we go back to our histogram again and break this into pie charts, our 600 acre feet of consumptive use, we know what's going on there. It was a good use of the water because it was consumed. But that return flow portion, as we look at it, we had some reasonable percolation, reasonable tailwater, reasonable runoff, reasonable ponding, and I don't need to tell the farmers out there that you can't possibly irrigate and have everything you applied consumed. There are physical realities, there are realities with resources and water availability. So there are many reasons why there's going to be a reasonable amount of return flow, and we break this down in our pie chart. So the reasonable return flow really is all of our return flow, and there was no waste. We would say this irrigator, which is us, we've taken steps to eliminate waste, and there's no excessive return flow in our practice. So going back to our change of use example, what is the measure of our water right? Well, I think we've kind of answered that. You know where we're headed with this. Our consumptive use was 600 acre feet. That's the amount that can be transferred to a new use. The 400 acre feet cannot be transferred to a new use. Matter of fact, we have an obligation to make sure that 400 acre feet continues to get back to the river at the same time, at the same location, and in the same amount. Remember, our rule was that we cannot impact other water users having changed our use to a new use. Now we're going to tweak the example and go through it again quickly. We're going to divert an additional amount to protect our full decreed water right. Matter of fact, to use the terminology, we've been advised that we should use it so we don't lose it. In our example then, remember we have a 15 CFS water right, so we'll divert that entire amount onto the field. That's going to result in an application of probably 1,500 acre feet to the field over time, over the irrigation season. What's going to happen with our consumptive use? It's really not going to change because, remember, we said we have only so much land. We have the same crop. It was well irrigated before, so it's going to consume the same 600 acre feet. Of course, the math has to work out. That other 900 acre feet that we applied still returns to the river. That's 500 acre feet more than before. Remember, it was 400 acre feet before. Now with our new practice, we have 900 acre feet going back to the river. So on one hand, we could look and say no harm, no foul. We buttressed our water right. But looking at our histogram, it looks a little differently. We left only 5 CFS in the river. So we did have an impact on the river and maybe some water rights in that intervening reach. Our consumptive use stayed the same, and our return flow is at 900 acre feet. So there is a lot more going on there with water going back to the river. Let's go back to the same pie chart. The consumptive use portion does not change. Crop ET is the same, 600 acre feet. But our return flow portion looks a lot different, where we had mostly or nearly all reasonable amounts of percolation, tailwater, and so on in this area before. Now we have some excessive percolation because we had so much ponding going on. We have excessive tailwater. Water ran out the end of the ditch. Excessive water running off the field and ponding on the field. So these components here really constitute waste. And if we break it down, the reasonable amount of the return flow is now a smaller fraction. There was a significant amount of waste. And what that means is that practice has not necessarily taken water from the river. Remember, down here, we left only 5 CFS in the river, which impacts other water rights in that intervening reach and just impacts the flow of the river and the riparian system. Remember, we set out to do a change of water rights, so we're still interested in that. And we know that of that consumptive use portion, that entire amount can be transferred to the new use, as we said before, and we can't transfer that 900 acre feet to the new use. So again, we might say no harm, no foul, but we may have outsmarted ourselves a little bit, because not only can this 900 acre feet not be transferred to a new use, we have a greater return flow obligation. Remember, some of these return flows occur through the ground, through in delayed fashion. So we may be out looking for water that we can use in the winter, maybe from a reservoir, or we're having to do recharge to a greater extent just to keep that winter return flow obligation and those delayed return flows up. And this is a good time to just make a note about augmentation. How do we maintain those return flows? Well, it's through an augmentation plan. That augmentation plan does the calculations and understands where the return flows occurred in time, location, and amount, and it provides a source of water to replace those return flows and ensure that other water users on the river are not injured. So our return flow obligation, and therefore our augmentation obligation, just got somewhat more difficult by to the tune of 500 acre feet by our greater diversion in our change of use case. So I'll just tie this together. I think with everything you see, after our change, 6 CFS goes to this big factory in the municipality, 9 CFS returns to the river. We see the 14 CFS down below still there, so everything is whole. In our change of use example, as we said, we can transfer only the same 600 acre feet. We need to leave behind 900 acre feet. Because we've created this waste, we've diverted water unnecessarily. It's a statutory conflict. It has impacts on the river, and it really wasn't necessary. it wasn't part of the beneficial use of that water right, that waste amount. So where do we end up? The diversion, as we say, we know that it kind of self-defines. It's the amount diverted from the river. Beneficial use is that amount of diversion that is reasonable and appropriate, or in other words, necessary to accomplish the use. In our case, it was the 10 CFS. It was the 1,000 acre feet, not the 15 CFS. Consumptive use, that's amount that was taken out of the system by the decreed use. In our case, that was 600 acre feet, or about 6 CFS. And then for return flows, that is the amount that was diverted but wasn't consumed. And, you know, as we say, it needs to go somewhere. It's going to end up back to the river. That's the direction of flow. In our case, that was 400 acre feet in our first example. In our second example, of course, it was 900 acre feet. Either case, it is the return flow amount that creates that obligation.
So, Kevin, yeah, thank you. That's outstanding. So, second speaker is Bill Trampe. Bill is a third-generation rancher from Gunnison County. His ranch is located between Gunnison and Crested Butte, and it has been in the Trampe family for over a century. Bill served on the Upper Gunnison Water Conservancy District for 26 years, as well as the Colorado River District Board, where he has represented Gunnison County since 2003. And Bill also serves on the Gunnison Basin Roundtable. In 1996, Bill co-founded the Gunnison Ranchland Conservation Legacy, which is an organization created to help preserve agricultural land. And so far, the Conservation Trust has protected over 16,000 acres of ranchland in the Gunnison-Crested Butte area through conservation easements. In 2015, the Colorado Water Congress presented Bill with the Wayne Aspinall Water Leader of the Year Award. The Aspinall Award is given annually in recognition of a career of service and contribution to Colorado's water community. Bill is going to be sharing with us today a perspective that is informed by several decades as a livestock producer in the high country in the Gunnison River Basin. So, Bill, I will turn it over to you now.
Thank you, Phil. It's good to be with you folks. Good afternoon. And congratulations to our new state engineer. I just want to give you a brief background of our operation here in the Gunnison Valley. I live north of Gunnison, about 6 miles, an elevation of about 8,000 feet. And most of our hay land is right here around the home place, roughly 700 acres of hay ground here. And then about halfway to Crested Butte, we have another 300 to 400 acres, depending on how much of it we want to cut. And then we move on into the high country around Crested Butte, where we have about half of our acreage, and a half of that half is irrigated in from small tributaries to the East River. And the elevation of that country is from 9 to 10,000 feet. With our government permits, the Forest Service permits surrounding those parcels of private land, and those elevations range up to about 11,500 feet. So that gives you some idea of geographically kind of what's going on around here. Our cattle population is all composite cattle, pretty much managed on a typical high country management scheme. Feed hay too many months of the year. Generally, we're feeding pretty much full time by Christmas time, sometimes by the 1st of December, and we're feeding hay through part of May. Calving in April, primarily a little late in March and April, finish up in May. Cows start going out of the home place. All the calving's done here at the home place. Pre-weaning vaccinations going on about mid-October. Wean those calves the last part of October, the last 4 or 5 days of October, and haul the calves back to the Gunnison base and utilize our post-haying regrowth here in the meadows until we get snowed off of these meadows here in November, first part of December. The cows stay in the high country until we get snowed out. Generally, it's about Thanksgiving time. Then we come down the highway. That's the only trailing we do on the highway anymore is when we come out. And like most situations, snow is a benefit to some and a detriment to others. And there is a meeting of the minds. And usually we're coming down the road the same day that the ski area opens. So it's always lots of fun when we're trailing down the highway. The cows are wintered. The mature cow herd is wintered in the Jack's Cabin area, which is about halfway between here and Crested Butte. And the younger cows are moved clear down here to the home place. Along about the middle of February, the 1st of March, then the mature cow herd is trucked on down here and we're preparing for calving. So you've kind of seen the possibility of how our seasonal migration around our resources work. Our irrigation here at the home place is out of the Gunnison River, two major diversions of about total of 250 CFS. We usually start irrigating late April and get it going great by the 10th, 15th of May on a normal year and continue on until about this time of year, depending upon when the monsoon hits and how hard it hits. We start turning ditches down around the middle of July to the 20th of July, preparing for haying. And then haying lasts for a month to 6 weeks, depending on how much monsoon we have. And we generally try to get some water back on the meadows here at the home place after haying's over. And so we've still got some growing season going on in September. The hay meadows in Jack's Cabin, the East River is getting low enough that it's not beneficial to try to get back into irrigating in the East River. The small streams that we irrigate with up country are small tributaries of the East River, and generally we try to keep going up there until the 1st to the 10th of August. But after that, the water supply has gone down enough that it's really not very productive to try to do much up there in the later season. So that's kind of a background of our operation and how we operate. Phil, do you have specific places that you want me to go?
Phil, that is just a great walkthrough of high country irrigation management. I suspect a lot of us were probably not as familiar as we would have liked to have been. So on that topic, so it's amazing the amount of work that goes into trying to get the water moved around where it needs to be, as well as moving the cattle around at the same time and trying to manage. So, you know, a couple questions that I thought it would be great for you to answer is one of the things that people, when people see ranchers flood irrigating and water running off the edge of meadows, some people perceive that as water being wasted. But I wanted to get your take on what happens to that water in your country when it leaves the edge of that meadow.
We do divert large amounts of water, and you have to stop and think about the geographical areas that we're trying to irrigate. A lot of the high mountain country, the mesas or even the areas close to the river level are full of cobble and sand and gravel. And there's not a great deal of topsoil on a lot of it. Some of it has great topsoil, but it's very spotty. And so in order to get the water to go over the surface, you have to do what we call build a sub. And all we're trying to do is build a water table that's high enough that allows the surface applications to be able to go farther across the landscape. And so it does take large amounts of water to accomplish that. So we're building a big tributary aquifer. We're filling that, and we're trying to have enough water to get off the end of the meadows. And a lot of that is going on to the neighbor's ranch next door, or it runs off and it goes directly back to the river. And so then you've got the aquifer recharge, or you have the charged aquifer, and that water continues to work out even after you turn off the ditches and you go into the hay field, and that water is returning back to the river at some rate. It continues to decline, but in our country, in my particular situation, that water is continuing to return to the river way up until November and December. So what does that do? That creates a whole different set of circumstances that lots of people don't understand. it widens the riparian corridor to a large extent. And that one photo, I think you had it up for a little bit, Kevin or Phil, that in the, that you saw trees and some cattle in the background. That's of a riparian corridor that's been enlarged by a lot of the return flows back to the stream. And interestingly enough, those are return flows that are not coming from direct surface. It's water coming out of the banks of these mesas and then being collected in drainages that, that can be irrigated out of, or it returns to the river and really become side streams of the river that very good fishing and a lot of good wildlife habitat has had in some of those areas. So that's what happens to all that excess water that lots of people call waste. And I would leave it to Kevin to tell me whether it is or not, but it's been historically applied that way for probably 60, 70 years once that the people that developed the country got their ditches to the large enough and their water rights in place enough that they felt like they were covering the property adequately to grow a hay crop.
Yeah, that's a great run through on that. And one of the things you mentioned, the retiming that happened as a result of the aquifer recharge and some other activities, that does in fact help to sustain stream flow during drier periods, I think, and also is probably utilized by wildlife as well in those areas that might otherwise be dry. Is that a fair statement?
That's a fair statement, and something that lots of people don't thoroughly understand is the economic advantage to communities that creates. That riparian habitat, fishery, all help benefit different aspects of recreational life here in the Gunnison Valley. And something that is really advantageous is to the rafting industry on the major streams like the Gunnison River, where you get a lot of fall flow that way, which helps the floating industry, which is becoming quite popular here in the Gunnison. And I have a friend that's heavily engaged in that, and he says their September business anymore is greater than their August business. So it's interesting that they can float the river that strongly in September compared to August.
This question's for Kevin. Kevin, irrigators have expressed concern that the law currently protects consumptive use, but not rate of diversion. So if an irrigator goes to a more efficient use and therefore reduces that diversion, but later on cannot maintain that efficient use, it needs to go back to a less efficient or in this case, let's say flood irrigation system, their ability to do so could be lost. Now, this is the person's opinion, their ability to do so to be lost. So you need to address that. Would it make sense to change the law to protect the ability to return to the former diversions in this case, assuming consumptive use will remain the same and no change in water rights? Can you address that, Kevin?
Thanks, Terry. I sure can. It's a good question for illustrating some of this use it or lose it discussion we've had over the years. And I would start by saying I believe that the law does provide for that. And it's the concern that the word that wasn't used, but I think the concern is abandonment of some portion of a water right. And let's go back to my example with a 15 CFS water right. And let's say that many years ago, we switched to a center pivot and we became more efficient and we only needed the 10. So what happened to that 5 CFS? Well, we haven't been diverting it, so it is subject to the consideration of abandonment. Now, that consideration really looks at, have you for 10 years not been using that 5 CFS? Well, that's an easy call. What's not such an easy call is, what was the intent of the irrigator? Did the irrigator have an intent to abandon that water right? If that irrigator can make a pretty straightforward showing that I'm trying with a center pivot, I want to leave it open to go back to flood irrigation, I think they've already overcome that concern about intent to abandon, and the water court then can look at that and say, there is no intent to abandon, the 5 CFS remains as part of the water right. So that was kind of a specific example, but it all goes back to there's a consideration of abandonment if the water is not being diverted for a period of years, but the water right cannot be abandoned if there was no intent, and the water user gets a chance to show that.
Thanks, Kevin. And is there any addition on that point as it relates to when the water right might be sold somewhere in the future related to the efficient use and leaving that 5 CFS in the river? Do you have any comments on that?
Sure. And that's a somewhat different discussion, and it's a little more difficult because, remember, sticking with our example, our entire 15 CFS was decreed for a certain area of land that's going to be described by the water right. It's for this section of land described as follows. We were able to get in line in the priority system based on that non-speculative beneficial use. So if we become more efficient and we find that we have 5 CFS available as part of that specific water right, unfortunately for us, that 5 CFS is not ours to do with as we want. For example, sell it to a municipality or make a deal with neighbors downstream. It has to go back into the prior appropriation system to be diverted by the next one in line. I'll just make a note that we have this discussion from time to time. That sounds rather harsh because, after all, we had that water right. But if you were the next junior water right down the line, and you found that Kevin and the rest of the folks with the 15 CFS water right no longer need all that for their priority beneficial use, and instead they're leasing it to someone else that has no water right or is very junior, I think you'd expect the prior appropriation system to be abided by, and you would want that water delivered to you as the next most senior right. So it's a tough discussion to have.
All right, thank you. There's several more questions coming in. We're not going to be able to get to all of them, but we will ask as many as possible. This question is for Bill, and it's that the person that typed in the question appreciated the comments on the soil conditions in the Gunnison Valley. They're sure that you want to keep as much of that soil on the field as possible. Have you had to adapt your irrigation techniques, keeping soil erosion in mind? Of course, this is meadow irrigation, but go ahead, Bill, if you have a comment related to that.
I'm not aware of any place where erosion of the topsoil has been a problem in relation to the amount of water that we're putting on those meadows. And you have to realize it's not crop irrigation. It's meadow, grass, hay, alfalfa type application.
Thanks, Bill. Do you have another question or two, Phil? We've got some more coming in, but I'll hand it over to you for some that have been pre-submitted.
Well, yeah, just to mix it up a little bit, this is related but on a different track. One question is, many delivery canals and ditches in Colorado are earthen and lined, and this question is for Kevin. These canals would work great for recharge in many cases, but under current law, the only time they can get credit for seepage is when there are no deliveries taking place. How can we work through this such that there might be incentives for extending water diversions into canals to recharge the aquifer?
And that, thanks, Phil. That question touches on a couple areas, but of course, we do have ditches. I'm familiar with ditches on the South Platte that at times when they are not diverting their irrigation water, they are diverting a more junior water right to be recharged through the bed of the ditch and ultimately to take credit for that recharge at the river. So that is being done, but it is that different color of water. It's that junior water right. It doesn't have to be junior, that's not the point, but it is a different water right decreed for recharge back to the river, and the irrigation water right would not carry that because the irrigation water right's beneficial use is for irrigation of crops or grass or hay, and any seepage that occurs is just that incidental loss that can't be claimed for recharge because that that wasn't part of the decreed beneficial use. So hopefully that kind of distinguishes how that would work.
Kevin, can you think of circumstances where an irrigation efficiency upgrade and corresponding increase in historic consumptive use and reduction return flows might trigger the need to develop an augmentation plan or a substitute water supply plan?
One primary example, and it's somewhat of an anomaly, but in the Arkansas River Basin, and this is the good example, we found that part of our compact with Kansas on the Arkansas River states that any changes in particularly efficiency or other changes in the irrigation practice that would lower state line flows are not allowed by the compact. And what that means in practice is if an irrigator becomes more efficient and there is less water than through the return flow that would have ended up at the state line, instead that amount of water is left in the ditch for someone else to use, or the irrigator puts it on different land, that impacts the compact, or that is a compact violation. So in that case, about 10 years ago, Dick Wolf, the state engineer, did the irrigation improvement rules in the Arkansas that describes how you can make those irrigation improvements and still keep us in compliance with the compact. But let me say more generally throughout the state, and of course there are nuanced exceptions, but more generally, a water user is allowed to become more efficient, and if that allows the water user to irrigate other land that is allowed by that decree, they get to do that. If they become more efficient and that reduces return flows, they get to do that as long as they're acting within the bounds of their water right decree.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. Now, I wanted to see if we could unpack a little bit more. I think you made a statement that when a water user becomes more efficient and may realize savings in how much water they are diverting, that can be applied to another field if their decree allows. Now, there would be many instances where that would not be allowed. Isn't that right?
Sure, Phil. There would be situations where it would not. I really wanted to illustrate a point that an efficiency change that reduces the need to divert water, that amount we can't just do anything with it. We certainly can use it within the bounds of our decree, but maybe you need to give me a better example of where maybe it couldn't be done.
I guess there is some competing schools of thought there relative to what we can do when we install irrigation efficiency upgrades. And if we have, for example, return flows that are being used by down gradient users, and we reduce those return flows through an irrigation upgrade, efficiency upgrade, as you had mentioned, we're still on the hook to make sure that they get that same amount of water one way or another. And so that's why I was wondering, I guess just for point of clarification, in effect, we are still obligated to make sure that those downstream users get their water just as they have.
Great. I'm glad to have the chance to clarify this, because that example that I went through was specific to a change of use case where we want to use the law to change to another use, and the law says you can do that, but you cannot impact other water users. So in that case, we do need to maintain that return flow pattern by law. But if we're making efficiency change, we're acting within the bounds of our decree. So when we switch from that flood irrigation to center pivot and reduce return flows, we're still acting within the bounds of our water right, and we don't have an obligation to ensure that the return flows are the same for the water users downstream. Did that distinction come through good?
Yeah, that's fantastic. That's, I think, answers a lot of people's questions right there.
So last question, this is for Mr. Trampe. Bill, it's not often we're blessed in these scenarios with an old water buffalo like yourself that has the ability to look into the future a little bit. So maybe we'll close this webinar out with a couple parting comments from Bill Trampe as he looks into kind of the near and then a bit further future as it relates to irrigated agriculture and some of the challenges and opportunities we have. So, Bill, would you leave us with those thoughts?
Well, in Western Colorado, it's a little bit scary as I look to the future. We have all the urban demands on the Front Range with all the Trans Mountain diversions, and we have all the demand on the West Coast and the demand in the desert areas, Nevada and Arizona. So Western Colorado agriculture, I think, is really kind of on the precipice of what the future holds. What federal judge is going to tell the people in the urban areas of the Front Range that they can't have water when you've got irrigation going on in the high mountains in particular that people view as wasteful? I think the real crux of the thing is, are we all going to be able to make changes to whatever we're doing, whether it's municipalities, whether it's irrigators, whether it's industry? Can we all make changes that allow us all to continue to do what we're doing at some level? And I think that's the challenge. We hope that we can keep enough water in Powell to generate electricity. I think that's more important, or that's the critical thing about Lake Powell versus the compact. I think Lake Powell will be unable to produce electricity before we have a compact curtailment issue come up the river. So I'm looking at a lot of different things, but I don't see anything that's going to be easy as far as irrigated agriculture in Western Colorado.
Well, I think you summed it up very well, Bill. There is nothing easy about water in Colorado, to be sure. Well, we are, unfortunately, at our closing end of our webinar. We have many more questions than time to answer, so we're going to try to capture those questions that have been posed and get with Kevin and Bill and get responses together, and we're going to post those on our website at coloradocattle.org/agwaternetwork, so stay tuned for that. And we will also be posting this webinar on the website as well, so check back. I also want to point out that another good reference on this topic of use it or lose it, irrigation efficiency and historic consumptive use, is the Colorado Water Institute's special report number 25, which is entitled How Diversion and Beneficial Use of Water Affect the Value and Measure of a Water Right. If you have any additional questions or comments after the webinar, please feel free to email those to Aaron or myself. Aaron's email again is aaron@coloradocattle.org. Mine is phil@brinkinc.biz. That's phil@brinkinc.biz. Again, we want to thank the Walton Family Foundations for its financial support of the Ag Water Network, and also a special thanks to our speakers today for sharing their insights. This concludes today's webinar.